Hi everyone, welcome back. I'm Michael Sandler, best-selling author and your host on Inspire Nation. Check out our website where you'll find videos, podcasts, tips, and more at InspireNationShow.com. Today we're going to be talking about an unknown epidemic that affects over 80% of us. If you've ever had low energy, heart problems, anxiety or depression, asthma, diabetes, arthritis, joint pain or high blood pressure, or autoimmune disorders, or almost any other modern health challenge, then today's show is truly for you. Today I'm very excited to have one of the world's leading experts on magnesium and magnesium deficiency on the show with us. Her name is Dr. Carolyn Dean. She's not only a medical doctor, but she's a naturopath, herbalist, acupuncturist, and nutritionist, as well as a lecturer, consultant, and author. For over 15 years, she's made it her mission to help people understand the dangers of magnesium deficiency and how this one simple mineral, simple, can make all the difference in the world. Reading three of her books, and she has over 30 books and 110 Kindles of them, I am blown away by the amount of research behind how much magnesium can help. Today we'll talk about how to tell if you have a magnesium deficiency, why so many of us are deficient, what it means to be deficient, and what you can do to turn things around starting today. Well, welcome to the show, Carolyn. Are you ready to shine?
Absolutely. Let the magnesium burn.
Woohoo! We were talking off air before how my high school physics teacher almost lit the entire school on fire when showing us how brightly magnesium burns, and he caught a roll of paper towels on fire, and the roll unraveled the entire way across the classroom with a small wall of flames. Magnesium charged. So before we dive into things, I met you a few years ago when we first arrived on the island of Maui. Mm-hmm. And I must apologize to you. I was not very present with you. Mm-hmm. And I was not very present because I was in the middle of a blood sugar crash, something of which I yo-yoed nearly my entire life until I started having green smoothie after green smoothie after green smoothie from a farm that remineralizes their soil. Mm-hmm. I had no idea, and I wish that I had really had the brain power to speak with you at that time. I had to go full circle that may have actually been magnesium driven.
Mm-hmm. I'm sure it was, Michael, because what we know about greens is if they get the magnesium from the soil, mm-hmm. then the greens can supply us with a lot of magnesium. But I will tell you that I have seen enough people in the raw food movement and the 140 ounces of green smoothies a day with magnesium deficiency to confirm that the soil, for the most part, is deficient in magnesium. And that's why we're only getting maybe 200 milligrams of magnesium in our diet these days, instead of what we used to get 100 years ago was 500 milligrams.
And I was fascinated where I read in one of your books, I think, there was somebody testifying before Congress that mm-hmm. In like the 1930s of how deficient our soil was. And that's because you grow the same crop time after time after time, mm-hmm. generation mm-hmm. after generation.
Right. Right, and it hasn't changed, and it's probably gotten worse, because once we started putting more and more chemicals in the soil and doing the testing on those chemicals, it turns out that, you know, one of the crazy Monsanto chemicals binds magnesium for about 30 years.
Oh,
and
wow.
Has it's
we're
incredible.
We're not getting that.
Yeah. So in order to make the plants look good, it's to the detriment of the minerals.
So let's dive into things at the very beginning. So I read your books. I'm going down this rabbit hole completely and totally. As I'm reading it, I've only got this magnesium chelate, and so I'm taking a little more and a little more, going, well, maybe I'm getting my 4% out of it. But everybody today says, well, it's this one thing or it's that one thing. And it's really, really confusing for people. So can you make a case for us of why, and after reading three of your books, I'm fairly convinced, why a great starting point is magnesium?
I think it's because it is necessary for over 700 to 800 different enzyme systems in the body. That's a lot of biochemical processing. And that starts with your energy system, the ATP. Mm-hmm. If you don't have magnesium, you don't have energy. And
so,
what do
so
people...
when we're dragged, drained, at the end of the day, yeah. we're... It's mm-hmm. not so much that that's the natural way to be. Mm-mm. It could be that we're depleted.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So there's 8 steps in the Krebs cycle to make energy.
Yep.
6 of those steps require magnesium.
Uh-oh. And if not, no ATP, no glucose, no energy, no nada.
Yeah. So that's where I begin. If you want energy, you get magnesium, but then it's so much greater than that. The magnesium helps metabolize carbohydrates, proteins, and fats. Mm-hmm. It helps make insulin. It helps open up the cells to let the glucose in. It helps dampen down the cortisol and the adrenaline. It supports your adrenal glands. It supports your thyroid. And I can go on and on and on, but that's why I've written so much so people can read these things.
So what are some of the key signs then that you are among the 80% of us that may have a magnesium deficiency?
Fatigue, insomnia, muscle cramps, heart palpitations, irritability. Those are the major ones that people go to doctors with all the time. And then there's the bone problems, because magnesium is crucial to make bones that are strong and supple and not brittle.
So if, like for myself, I had a near-death accident 2 years ago where my bones exploded on impact, and there was a lot of force, but it was a shattering unlike anything the doctors had ever seen. And since that time, I've had my bone density checked. And my bone density would be that of an 80-year-old plus male. I thought I was eating very healthy. So talk to me about this.
Right, and usually we think of the osteoporosis in women. Mm-hmm. But what's happening in the youthful population who wants to eat right, et cetera, if you don't eat greens that have magnesium, you're getting a lot of calcium.
Yeah.
If you're eating a lot of fermented dairy, like yogurt and kefir, you're getting a tremendous amount of calcium and no magnesium.
I've heard of you talking about us drowning in calcium, because my mind thinks, it used to think anyway, calcium mm-hmm. good. Mm-hmm. And you're saying that if we get the calcium without magnesium, we're in trouble.
Correct. It's a balance. It's always a balance. And what happens with calcium, straight calcium, you think of a piece of chalk. Mm-hmm. You drop that chalk, it'll shatter. But if you have calcium, magnesium, and of course the collagen, the boron, you know, there are other things involved, but I start with magnesium. You will get rubberiness of the bone. That's not the right word at all.
A but suppleness, the bone, maybe we'll call it.
What's that?
Suppleness.
Yeah, suppleness. Yeah, I tried to say that earlier. I didn't think I pronounced it right, so I was looking for another word. But yes, kind of a flexibility, and it's not going to shatter. And that's what's difficult to get across to doctors these days, until actually there's 6 studies now that show that women who simply take calcium supplements are at higher risk for heart disease. So all that calcium is depositing in their arteries, and it's also depositing in their breast tissue. This whole epidemic of DCIS, mm-hmm. disseminated intraductal carcinoma, is just calcium precipitating in the soft tissues, and it's being misdiagnosed as cancer in a lot of cases.
So 2 big questions that come up. First, can we remineralize the bone properly so that it is no longer so it's more shatter resistant glass, shall we say. And then the second question is, can we use magnesium as a flush? I'm thinking of our pipes, which get a calcium buildup on it.
Right, right. Yes, good points, because the reason calcium does what it does, precipitates and all that, mm-hmm. is because the body's trying to hold, grab onto that calcium for dear life.
Yep.
Because evolutionarily, humanity grew up around oceans where there was less calcium and more magnesium. Ocean water has three times the magnesium.
Fascinating.
So in order to get the calcium we needed, what, from the little fish bones? Then we didn't have cows back then. Mm-hmm. So we grabbed onto calcium using vitamin D, mm-hmm. and these mechanisms that actually make you constipated if you take calcium. It's like your intestines go slower to absorb all that calcium.
Okay,
magnesium is the opposite.
So, wow, so many topics to go down. So, magnesium for not only flushing out our arteries, but then getting our intestines more motile. And go ahead.
Yes, exactly. Magnesium has a laxative effect. If you take, quote, too much magnesium, you'll flush it out. You'll never build it up. So magnesium actually dissolves calcium. You mix some calcium powder, some magnesium powder, the calcium dissolves. And it does that in the body. I have testimonials of people, their carotid artery calcification dropping by 30 to 40% when they get themselves saturated with magnesium.
Fascinating. And then jumping into, when we're talking about bones, the buzzword of today tends to be vitamin D.
Oh.
And how much vitamin D, I've been guilty of this myself, how much vitamin D can I get in balanced with K? Not how much vitamin D can I get in balanced with K, but maybe cut it down because it's blocking magnesium absorption. Help?
Help, I know, it's crazy. You know, once we found out calcium was causing all these problems, the medical community went to vitamin D as the next sexy nutrient. And I know patients come to me, I do telephone consultations, or I used to, and they're on 50,000 units of vitamin D, and the old RDA used to be 400. What happens with vitamin D? It's a hormone, it's not a nutrient. If it's low in the blood, it means that the body doesn't need it at this time. It may very well mean that vitamin D, whose main job is to grab calcium, has grabbed enough calcium and you don't need any more. So then you go, oh, it's low, we better give it, and we better give
it to stop
a lot.
You right there briefly, what you're saying is there may not be an epidemic of vitamin D deficiency that we're treating, because so many people are treated with vitamin D deficiency, so many people are quote unquote low. You're saying that's just the body's way of bringing about homeostasis, balancing itself.
To try to get rid of the calcium.
Wow.
We've already talked about how we've got all this calcium. Orange juice is fortified with calcium. You know, kefir, in 1 ounce, there's 40 milligrams. You take 10 ounces.
I've been living on kefir right now to try to rebuild my bones, and because of this whole issue of mold toxicity we talked about earlier, I've been doing kefir until I read these books. Well, that and my stomach has been, you know, screaming at me for obvious reasons.
Mm-hmm.
So let's jump into one thing at a time. First, I need to go back to the bones real briefly. You got brittle bones. You've got a lot of calcium in there, but you don't have your magnesium. And
right.
Reading the book, you may have some magnesium bound with fluoride that was in your water, that was in your greens, that is in your tap water.
Right.
What do we do? Is there a way to flush this out of the bones? Do we need to be taking boron? Do we need to go high on magnesium? Are we stuck?
No, it's just magnesium. Just hydration, sea salt, magnesium. There are other minerals involved, but you start with the magnesium.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't listen to people who say, oh, well, you've got a leaky gut, so you're not going to absorb anything anyway. You really need the magnesium to help with all the other processes. And actually, I went through that myself because I have an irritable gut, and I could not take any magnesium pills or powder, so I had to create my own. So mm-hmm. there are better absorb magnesiums that don't cause the laxative effect. So yes, if you saturate with magnesium, if you hydrate, if you start taking magnesium and minerals that are well absorbed, that get into the cells, you need to take enough water to get into the cells with those minerals to do their job. A lot of people who start taking minerals say, oh, I feel so dehydrated. What's wrong with these minerals? No, you're not hydrating. You need half your body weight in pounds. Mm-hmm. Take that number and in ounces of water.
That's quite a lot of water.
It is. And I mean, people are drinking 2-3 glasses a day and they probably need 6-8.
But you're saying with the minerals, throw in the sea salt, put in, in essence, it was one of my questions I had for you is, let's make a magical world here where we create our own healthy, healthy sports drink. Because there's so much talk about getting our electrolytes, in quotes.
Right.
How would we make our own healthy sports drink?
Yeah, well, you wouldn't put in sugar, okay?
Oh,
forget
no.
The sugar. And most sports drinks are just sodium and sugar and nothing else. So, and that's a travesty. What? Okay, so if you weigh 100 pounds, that's 50 ounces of water.
Yep.
In every quart, which is, what, 32 ounces, mm-hmm. you put a quarter teaspoon of sea salt.
Okay.
And you drink that through the day. What I do with my water is I'll have my sea salt and also my own liquid magnesium and my own liquid multiple minerals. So I'm sipping my minerals all through the day. I don't take it in a shot.
Yep.
Like if you take all your magnesium at once, then you know, there is a good tendency to get diarrhea with that. You'll lose the amount that doesn't go into your cells.
Unless somebody's been having way too much calcium. And which case,
right, which they're constipated, right.
It may have a balancing effect to
You know, the other thing, Michael, I should mention right now is the amount of calcium that the RDA says you need, the recommended daily allowance is like 1,200, 1,500 milligrams of calcium. That's way too high. What I follow the UK and World Health Organization values, and they're at 500 to 700 milligrams. So I go for 600 milligrams of calcium, at least 600 of magnesium, so it's 1-to-1. Back to your kefir, to really hammer this point into your bones.
Oh, no. Pun intended.
Yeah. The 1 ounce of kefir has 40 milligrams of calcium and 4 milligrams of magnesium.
1-to-10 ratio.
10-to-1 ratio. And you need a 1-to-1 ratio to get the balance for doing all the magnesium processes in the body and keeping your bones healthy.
What things do have a 1-to-1, or are there any out there?
Good point. Chocolate, maybe.
All
cacao.
Right.
Yeah, cacao could be. That's a good point. You'd have to look at my books. I have some free magnesium books people can look at ratios.
Now you talk about 600 milligrams. But now, one of the things I read in your book is that not all magnesium is created equally. So I was looking at my bottle of chelated magnesium going, my wife got me the good stuff. And she really did her research on this. And I read in your book then chelated maybe 4%. And I'm going, oh, no.
Well, it's 4% is the magnesium oxide.
Okay.
And that people will use as a laxative. They know that it's going to flush them out.
Okay.
So the 4% is absorbed and may get into your cells. We don't even know. That 4% is going into the blood. The rest goes into the intestines and boom. So people get turned off. Doctors who see the studies that use magnesium oxide, they give to their patients, oh my gosh, you know, it's causing too much diarrhea, which can be a problem itself because you'll lose minerals. The chelated ones and the magnesium citrate powders, they may be up to 20% absorbed.
Okay.
So what you're looking at a pill that says 400 milligrams, 20%, okay, oh, I'm getting 80 milligrams. Oh, that means I have to take about 10 of these pills to get an effect. And for me, with my heart palpitations and horrible leg cramps, if I took one pill, I would get diarrhea. So I worked for 10 years trying to get mineral companies to make a magnesium that had no laxative effect, mm-hmm. no luck, because it's a huge educational endeavor to educate people about magnesium and the different types. So anyway, I finally found a company that makes what I call a picometer-sized magnesium. I call it ReMag. And
pico is like 1/1,000,000th?
Yeah. It's so mini. It'll go right into the cells. And the unique processing, which takes a while and it is costly, the processing makes the ion stable enough that the magnesium will stay stable and then shoot into the cells. Otherwise, compounds in the body, like ours is a magnesium chloride, mm-hmm. the magnesium chloride binds and separates, like in fractions of a second. And your cell has to grab the magnesium when it unbinds. What the ReMag does is stabilize the magnesium ion so all of it goes into the cell. And we've got the clinical documentation to prove that a person who takes IV magnesium, for example, mm-hmm. someone who's so depleted and they get diarrhea whenever they take pills, they can take oral liquid ReMag and it will do better for them than intravenous, and they'll have higher blood levels than with intravenous. So we know it really works, and it's quite fascinating.
So there are so many conditions, which I want to get into in a couple minutes here, all the possible conditions that magnesium deficiency affects. But before we get to that, it almost seems like as a baseline, we all, almost all of us, probably all of us, should be taking some magnesium and seeing how it affects us. If this, it's sort of like an experiment of one. I'm wondering if that is a valid way to approach this, and if so, what amounts do we start with, and what are we likely to feel first?
Right. Yes, everybody, I think, should do the experiment that N equals one, where
absolutely.
N is the number of people in the experiment. You're the N equals one experiment for yourself. And because people will come to magnesium for, say, something, you know, really horrendous, like heart palpitations.
And you have a whole book on that, on heart palpitations. Something I've been experiencing this year in particular. So I was fascinated to read about this.
Right. So they might take magnesium for the heart palpitations, and then on my radio show, which I do on Mondays,
link for that?
AchieveRadio.com.
Okay, and we'll put
AchieveRadio.com.
That on the website.
Thank you. And people will phone up and say, well, I tried it for my atrial fibrillation, and that's gone, but also I'm sleeping better. My blood sugar levels have dropped. Because magnesium deficiency is one of the signs of diabetes, but doctors don't look at that. My leg cramps are gone. I'm less irritable. I have orgasms. Yes. And if you're tight and irritable, you're not even going to want to indulge. But
Like one of the quick points to put in here that I never thought about is calcium tightens muscles, magnesium relaxes them. So if you're drowning in calcium, you're rigid, frigid. You're in everything. Yeah. No wonder you can't poop.
I know. All that and more. And atherosclerosis is the deposition of calcium in the arteries. Mm-hmm. So all these people with heart disease, with blood pressure, that's another sign, symptom that goes away is blood pressure. And you know what's happening, Michael, with all these symptoms. You've got people with high blood pressure. They'll go to the doctor. They'll get put on a high blood pressure medication.
Yep.
A lot of these medications have fluoride in them.
Which
the fluoride binds
magnesium.
They come back, oh, your blood pressure's worse. We caught it just in time. And they give you two more blood pressure pills. a month later, you go back and your blood tests show that you now have diabetes and your cholesterol is elevated. All signs and symptoms of magnesium deficiency.
So, and then around and around goes the cycle, because now we're going to put you on some statins, we're going to put you on some other medication, and it's going to get worse till you're going to drop dead of all your medication.
Yes, but we've done the right thing medically.
Yes, we've treated, yeah. How does that expression goes? Something like surgery went great and the patient died.
Right. The surgery was a success, but the patient died. Yeah.
So, okay. So this brings up two topics. Let's see. First off, dosage again. Where do people start? She's showing, for all of you who are not watching this on YouTube, she is waving the glass of water in front of you that has magnesium in it, and an amount that a general population starts is approximately 300, approximately...
Well, this is very interesting. When I started talking about magnesium 15 years ago, it was, okay, get a pill or some powder that's... 300 milligrams and take a dose two or three times a day.
Yep.
But then when I found ReMag's absorption to be so incredibly high, what was happening is people who are very toxic, they would take ReMag at the, a one teaspoon, which is 300 milligrams, and say, oh my gosh, I feel worse. I started racing. I got too much energy. I can't sleep. They were turning on so many of their enzymes.
They're booting up.
They're booting up.
A reboot.
Really fast. And they were detoxifying because when the minerals get into the cells, they'll flush other things out that aren't necessary. Magnesium is important for the detoxification pathways in the liver, so they boot that up as well. So on our labels and on all our literature now, we say just start with a quarter teaspoon, which is 75 milligrams. And some people even say that's too much. There are a lot of toxic people out there. I've written a blog called Too Toxic to Detox, and that's where I really started pushing the hydration, because people really need to flush their systems.
Fascinating. This is making me think, and I always like to bring things home, because the more I can relate to it, I think more audience can relate to it. In my family, there's autoimmune disorders, and my sister's and her whole family has struggled with celiac, and she's doing the best she's ever done, but struggling with lupus. And I didn't trip across lupus in the book, but I wonder if there's a relation, I think there's a relation with celiac and gluten intolerance as well.
Well, there is all this business now about methylation. Everybody thinks it's about the MTHFR gene. I don't believe in genes as much as I believe in epigenetics. Genes are just there as little markers to make the proteins, and what makes genes turn on or off is the epigenetic factors of environment, vitamins, and minerals. Magnesium is the most important epigenetic turn-on factor that we know of, but again, it's being ignored.
So a starting point when somebody's struggling with these things, it may not be the end point, but there's no, that brings up another question. Is there any possible harm by starting into magnesium in this group that I'm discussing, autoimmune or gluten or celiac or any other group?
No harm, but then that's where I have to caution people to, to get the magnesium that they're going to absorb that's not going to irritate their intestines. I mean, when I was writing IBS for Dummies, I had to caution people not to take the magnesiums that were going to cause a laxative effect. And that's where we were getting into spraying magnesium on, taking Epsom salts baths. But personally, I couldn't spray enough on. I couldn't take enough baths to deal with my heart palpitations. So that's where I would would be telling people, well, for a medicinal magnesium, that's not going to cause a laxative effect on your Crohn's, your colitis, your celiac. You have to use something like my product, ReMag. It's the only one of its kind. But with autoimmune, what I go for there, Michael, is yeast overgrowth.
Okay. And that brings us home full circle to where Jessica and I are in the picture, which is we ended up leaving Hawaii a few months ago, leaving our home, which was found a week before we left with a carpet 1 inch thick, about 8 feet up, the whole way around the house of black mold. And what was happening is there was VOG. There was this volcanic emissions coming over from the Big Island. And also we were up at high altitudes. It was cold a lot, a very wet, damp year. And in all those conditions, we would seal up the house and seal ourselves into a black mold environment. Jessica got extremely ill. I got old. I was like a frail 80, 90-year-old, and we're out of that condition, but we're still in a humid environment where there's a little bit of mildew, and we're still struggling.
Wow. Right. And what I know about mold is that mold and yeast cross-react. Mm-hmm. So when I hear about people in moldy places, of course, you have to get out. There's no way you can amend what you're talking about. So you get out of the environment and you treat for yeast and mold at the same time. And the yeast treatment is avoiding sugars that feed the intestinal yeast. Mm-hmm. I used to say sugar, wheat, and dairy. Now I say sugar, gluten, and dairy because we have such a hard time digesting gluten. Probably the vicious cycle with our gut already leaky and everything. And then the intestinal treatment I use is psyllium seed, bentonite clay, and a liquid caprylic acid called caproil. And the three of them together, you mix them in just a couple of ounces of water because it's going to make jelly. You drink it quickly. Yucky jelly. So you drink that down, then follow it with 10 ounces of water. Okay. So what you're getting there is this clump of gel that sweeps through the intestines. The caprylic acid is killing the yeast. They explode apart, and the toxins are absorbed by the bentonite clay, and then the whole thing goes out the other end. Rather than those, get this, Michael, 178 different yeast toxins are created by Candida albicans.
Wow. And how many people are struggling with this?
Oh, my. You know, when I did do consultations, everybody who came to me had yeast, but they were self-selected. It's huge. It's huge. If you have taken one antibiotic, you can set yourself up for yeast. All the carbohydrates we're eating. And then you put the stress in there. When people have stress, they make cortisol, which feeds yeast. So I say let's go with 80% again, like we did with magnesium. So, you know, my two big focuses or foci are magnesium and yeast. And the way they go together is interesting because two of the real formidable breakdown products of yeast are alcohols and acetaldehydes. Acetaldehyde is called the hangover chemical, and that's what gives you brain fog. And in order to detoxify acetaldehyde, you need magnesium.
Fascinating.
So just
that's a condition both Jessica and I in that moldy environment. Jessica, for instance, she could be talking to you and she'd be and completely forget what she's talking about. Gone.
Wow.
34 it's years incredible. Of age, gone.
Yeah. Yeah, so we've got this situation now where we're kind of set up for yeast, and then we get that extra antibiotic or exposure to mold, or we start eating a lot of cold, damp foods. Mm-hmm. A lot of the, you know, the 30 age group.
And we were eating 30
year age
raw
group.
Most of that time. So
yeah.
Thinking that was perfect for us.
Right. And the Chinese medicine would say you're eating cold and damp in your lower abdomen.
Yes, they were right.
And that creates yeast. So. The Chinese didn't really talk about yeast overgrowth. Mm-hmm. They talked about dampness. So, you know, a lot of Chinese medicine practitioners don't even think about yeast. A lot of medical doctors don't think about yeast. I've been reading two books on the gut. Mm-hmm. Two books, one supposedly sold a million copies, and the other one, it just came out. I don't know how it's selling. They don't even mention yeast. Wow. Two books about the gut and the microbiome, yeah, and the bacteria this and the probiotic that. No mention of yeast. It's just not in, you know, it's like the mice, the monkeys, you know, where they can't see, they can't speak, and they can't hear. It's just horrendous. I mean, my two major challenges are getting people to understand magnesium deficiency and yeast overgrowth.
All right, I love it. So we've covered both of them to start with.
Yeah.
With that said, let's kind of do a speed round for the next 10 or 15 minutes. And let's try to cover, at least touch base. There are so many directions we can go, so I just want to go through a whole bunch of them and see where we get. First off, I read in your books that Epsom salt baths can be helpful for you, but Jessica wants me to ask, well, is an Epsom salt bath really good for you if you're, this is a bugaboo that both Jessica and I share, laying in warm water that has fluoride in it for that
right.
time?
Or chlorine.
Or, yeah, absolutely. So yeah. Does one okay. offset the other?
Well, the magnesium will kind of bind up some of the chlorine and fluoride, but what I do for that is tell people to put some clay in the bath.
Like bath
clay. I'm very big on clay baths. And I've done the test with chloride. I'm waiting for somebody to do the fluoride test. I put a chloride strip in my bath water. It goes bright. I put the clay in, mix it up. I put the chloride strip in, no chlorine left.
Woohoo! So how much clay are we talking about?
Clay. It could be like a quarter cup.
Okay.
But don't just throw it in. Blend it up.
Okay.
If you throw it in, it'll clump and just sit there and clog your drain.
So this is good. Yeah. Good for your skin health.
Which absolutely
actually segues into the next. Jessica was saying, I've never heard of anything or anyone that's actually been able to reduce wrinkles as they get older, and I was reading about magnesium and skin suppleness. Go.
I've been using magnesium on my face. I have the gravity wrinkles, but you know, I do think it helps the skin. I get my masseuse to put magnesium cream on my legs, and I'm, you know, I don't have the old lady wrinkle legs, but wrinkles have to do with dehydration and gravity. So what we can work on is the hydration, and then the best wrinkle reducer as you get older is a nice smile.
I like it. All right, magnesium and diabetes.
Yes, I already mentioned magnesium deficiency is a sign of diabetes. Doctors don't look for it because they just measure magnesium in the serum, where you only have 1% of the total body's magnesium. Mm-hmm. So that's where they ignored magnesium. It's not even on their electrolyte panel. So I send people to a website called requestatest.com.
And I went there after reading your book. So let me just give a little background filler for people. From what I understand, correct me if I'm wrong, when you tested the blood serum, that's the last place the body basically is going to hold reserves there. It could suck it out of your bones. It could suck it out of all of your cell. You're completely depleted and you've got zero available magnesium in your body, but your blood is going to show normal. But the other test, this test you're recommending, which is it's an RBC test, so it's in the red blood cells, that's
right.
Different.
It is different. It's better. It's not the best. Ionized magnesium is the best. Like I said, the ReMag has ions of magnesium, which is what you really want, and that's what you want to test. But the in-between test is the RBC magnesium. It's only $49, which, you know, if you go to a doctor, your copay is $50, so you can get the test without a doctor's prescription. But because we're talking about 80% of the population is deficient, you don't want to be in the range of the sick population. You want to be at the top of the curve. You want in a range of 4.2 to 6.8, you want to be around 6 to 6.5. So
and
that's
I think this is important to mention as well, that when you're looking at an average, and I'm putting that in quotes, it's an average of everyone. So if 80% of the population is deficient, you're looking at an average. You're looking at an average that has set the bar in the deficiency category.
Yeah, and thinks it's just fine. Oh, you're 4.2. Oh, no. You're fine. And there you're twitching and palpitating and your blood pressure is elevated and they're saying you're fine.
So, and I'm picturing, because I've had the twitch as well, and I'm twitching here in front of the camera. That's normal. okay. So website one more time. I think this is a website that gives people great freedom to go for the test.
Requestatest.com.
Perfect. We'll put that on the website as well. Magnesium for MS, ALS, and epilepsy.
Right. I've done a bit of blogging on that, because what happens is with epilepsy, it's the electrical conductivity in the brain gets misfired, mm-hmm. and magnesium helps any sort of nerve or muscle symptom. What I say about these conditions is please just saturate yourself with magnesium and see what you can do. And when people say how much or whatever, I think everybody needs 600 milligrams, and if you're taking drugs, if you have symptoms in spite of the 600 milligrams, take 900 milligrams. I have people who are taking 1200 milligrams.
And you say if you take too much, it just goes through you, so you don't have to worry about it.
Yeah, exactly. Even my ReMag, which is 100% absorbed, you'll get to a point where you take too much and you just release it. The body has that fail-safe, which is amazing.
Beautiful. Magnesium for autism.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, before I had my own ReMag, we put these kids in Epsom salts baths, and they did so well just by getting that magnesium into them.
Awesome. CoQ10 and magnesium.
Well, CoQ10, I mean, it is an animal product, so I don't tend to prescribe it. It's also something I think that's necessary in the Krebs cycle. Mm-hmm. But before I go to CoQ10, I tell people, look, 6 out of 8 steps in the Krebs cycle to make energy require magnesium. Start there. CoQ10 in the studies, you need very high amounts. So when you look at the labels, you may see CoQ10 and a little smidgen of it. You're just paying for the label.
Does magnesium protect the CoQ10 in the body and keep it from being...
That might be one question I don't know the answer for.
Okay.
But, you know, I think there's a synergism between nutrients, and I think magnesium probably is that grounding for all the nutrients.
How about for heart disease, the coronary arteries you mentioned a little bit earlier, heart disease, high blood pressure, cholesterol?
Magnesium is awesome. It will reduce cholesterol, because the enzyme that the statin drugs kill, mm-hmm. is balanced by magnesium. So if your cholesterol is too high, that enzyme will kick in, the magnesium will help bring it down. And if the cholesterol is too low, then the magnesium will kick in and help bring the cholesterol up. It's awesome. Whereas the Lipitor statin drug, it has a fluoride molecule. And what do people get with Lipitor side effects? Muscle cramping, spasms, and even rhabdomyolysis, which is a muscle breakdown.
So
horrendous.
What we're talking about on a completely different topic then, there's so many people I've trained at the end of their Ironman, for example. We struggled until we started doing a lot of mineral work with cramping. And you're saying the cramping isn't the electrolytes, it's plain spot on magnesium.
It is. It's dehydration magnesium, and potassium is in there as well. Mm-hmm. But what I do for potassium, because you can't really supplement it that much. The FDA puts a limit on how much.
It seems like it's a little bit dangerous if you put in too much of that.
Yeah. So you make your, that's your, where your green smoothies come in, mm-hmm. or you make your vegetable broths with all kinds of vegetables and potato peelings and everything. You drain off the fiber, just drink the broth. That's potassium.
Beautiful. And get more magnesium, preventing the muscle cramps as well. So then, okay, as we go down this list, mineral loss in teeth, because it's not enough magnesium maybe in the saliva?
Teeth. No, it's just teeth and bones require magnesium in order to make them dense enough, mm-hmm. and supple enough, and, you know, make them work properly. What happens with saliva is, yeah, too much calcium then will plaque up on the teeth and then build up the microbes and cause the cavities. So yeah, it may be not enough magnesium in the saliva, like you said, actually. Plus, definitely. Not enough in the bone, in the teeth.
Migraines, headaches.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, there's a doctor, Muskoff, who wrote a paper. The title was something like, "If you don't use magnesium in migraine therapy, you're stupid." He's so into magnesium. And I think he makes a magnesium product, but it's like a magnesium oxide, so it's kind of useless. Yeah, magnesium really works for migraines. It's amazing.
PMS and menstrual cramps and magnesium.
Right. Both of them are important. With the PMS, it's there's a hormonal component, not enough progesterone. There could be not enough vitamin B6, but magnesium absolutely is in there. In my Magnesium Miracle book, in the section for women's problems, I talk about what's necessary for PMS. But the cramping, you know, it's outright magnesium deficiency, and just the muscle cramping. Like you said earlier, Michael, magnesium relaxes muscles and mm-hmm. calcium cramps them up.
So it's why women may crave chocolate. No, this is something Jessica has struggled with in the past. Would you say Epsom salt baths then would also be very helpful?
Absolutely. Yes. They talk about a heating pad with dysmenorrhea, painful cramps. Well, the heat in an Epsom salt bath along with the magnesium is going to be very helpful.
Beautiful. How about menopause?
Yeah, that too, because magnesium is necessary for balancing the estrogen. These days we've got estrogen dominance, and it's not necessarily from too much estrogen naturally produced. It's from xenoestrogens, from plastics, from pollution, mm-hmm. from all the exogenous ways that we block up.
What about from tofu and things like that?
Well, I'm not too keen on soy. I had a bad run-in with soy when mm-hmm. I tried to be macrobiotic years ago, became allergic to it, and then I realized that most people do not digest soy properly. Mm-hmm. Have to be careful with soy products because they can be phytoestrogenic. It's a concern in baby formulas, for example, having all that estrogen. So okay. I'm not a soy proponent. I'm sorry.
Okay, no, that's quite all right, and I am a pretty much no soy in the diet as well. So, and that came from years of having all different chicken veggie burgers and yes. all sorts of soy stuff, and I've come full circle on that. A biggie that so many in the population are facing today: sleep and insomnia.
Yes, there's so many things about sleep and magnesium. It helps balance the serotonin, which is a feel-good hormone or neurotransmitter, I should say. It calms down your adrenals, it relaxes your muscles, it stops the irritability that cycles your mind into the critique and the worry cycles when you lie down. It does so many things that it'll help give you a deep enough sleep, and then you get up rested in the morning and you're able to take on the world. You're able to shine. I know.
And reading in your book, that's one of the first things that people, when they start taking magnesium that's absorbed, is they get their first good night's sleep in years. Mm-hmm. How about inflammation in general?
Oh yeah, that's huge. When I started hearing about the inflammation in heart disease and cancer, of course, autoimmune diseases, all the bowel diseases, and I look at magnesium, and it's the most important anti-inflammatory nutrient that you could possibly take. So when you look at what medicine does for inflammation with all the non-steroidal anti-inflammatories, and you look at their side effects, the side effects are very often magnesium deficiency side effects. Celebrex, for example, they kept taking it off the market. It's got fluoride molecules in it. So medically, they're treating inflammation with something that makes inflammation worse, basically. Wow. Magnesium is what you want to start taking.
Okay. Let's see here. Blood pressure and its relationship with building up a fluid, both in the blood and in your blood, the lungs, and the brain.
Right. So blood pressure... the smooth muscles of the arteries, mm-hmm. they will cramp up without magnesium, just like any other muscles. So then the artery will get tinier and tinier, mm-hmm. and that's blood pressure, back pressure on the heart will be created. Magnesium will relax that. The fluid retention business, I look at improper mineralization as causing this fluid buildup. Like you say, doctors will give a diuretic when you have blood pressure, thinking, well, let's get rid of this extra fluid. What they do is dehydrate people even more.
Oh, no.
And what you want is the minerals and the water to get inside the cells to do their job. When I get people hydrating with half their body weight in ounces of water, mm-hmm. 100 pounds, you're just 50 ounces of water, and their proper sea salt, their ReMag and ReMite, they no longer get up to go to the bathroom in the middle of the night. They're no longer running to the bathroom. Their fluids are not going in one end and out the other. They're going into the cells, doing their metabolic functions, being broken down, no longer being H2O anymore.
Yep.
And you're not urinating everything out.
I look forward to giving this more of a try. As does my wife, with me running back and forth. We'll whip through a few more of these real quickly. Arthritis, kidney stones, osteoporosis.
So arthritis, that's maybe the buildup of calcium in the joints or yeast toxins.
Mm-hmm.
So I'd be doing yeast treatment and magnesium to dissolve the calcium. And that goes for fibromyalgia as well.
Mm-hmm.
What were the other two?
Kidney stones.
Oh, gosh, yeah. I mean, that even doctors will recognize that magnesium helps dissolve kidney stones or prevents them, which is even better.
All right. Prostate cancer.
I don't know about prostate cancer. We haven't talked about cancer. When I talk about cancer, I go to something called German New Medicine or Total Biology.
Yes.
Which is the conflict basis of disease. The conflict of prostate cancer is the grandfather syndrome, mm-hmm. where a man does not see his progeny carrying on his line.
Mm-hmm.
So it's either a man who doesn't have grandchildren or he's worried that his daughter's going to get divorced and not have kids. It's a very interesting dynamic where the prostate is for reproduction and carry on the line. And the conflict about that can show up by the prostate cells growing, out of control.
Anxious.
Yeah.
So yeah. What about cancer in general?
Same thing. I go for the total biology. I mean, German New Medicine, just real quick, Dr. Gerd Hammer, mm-hmm. Psychiatrist, oncologist, his son was fatally wounded, died after 3 months of, you know, lingering on. Dr. Hammer sat by his bedside, you know, couldn't do anything for him. 3 months after his son died,
yep.
Hammer developed testicular cancer. Mm-hmm. His wife developed ovarian cancer.
Oh, no.
He could not avoid the fact that, you know, how incredible was that? The two regenerative organs, the two areas where they could produce another child, developed this extra tissue growth.
Wow. Wow.
Yeah.
So, okay, how about depression, anxiety, and panic attacks, mood disorders, things of this sort?
Yeah. Yeah, anxiety and panic attacks, the adrenal glands get overactivated. I think a lot of anxiety can, panic attacks can start from hypoglycemic episodes. Mm-hmm. Your blood sugar goes down, you're driving, you feel shaky and nervous, and you know yourself what hypoglycemia feels like. So you feel rotten and you go to your doctor and describe, oh, you had a panic attack. Here, you know, take Xanax, take Valium.
Years and years ago, I was given Xanax for having panic attacks, which were blood sugar related, and that made me more anxious and more panicky, and I melted down and had to get off of that. It was a mess.
Right. And depression, I mean, with depression, I have people, there's one gentleman who calls into the radio show now with depersonalization syndrome, he called it, and depression. He said that the magnesium and my other formulas are really helping him get out of that. I don't really consult with people with depression. I don't think it's a good idea to do that over the phone, but right. I refer people to truehope.com.
Okay.
And they have multiple vitamin mineral mega doses kind of along the orthomolecular Abram Hoffer protocols. So they have a product called Empower Plus, EMPOWER Plus. And they have, like, I think it's about 15 clinical trials now showing how effective this formula is for treating bipolar and manic depression.
Fascinating.
So I definitely refer to them.
We'll get that link on there so people can get over there as well. Thank you. Chronic fatigue and adrenal fatigue. And I think of Jessica when she comes home, or right now, being fatigued when you get up, or like an hour after you end up being exhausted.
Right. Especially when it's related to low blood pressure, that's adrenals. When you're lying down, you take your blood pressure, and you get up and your blood pressure drops. Your adrenal glands not compensating.
Oh, wow.
Now, what happens with the adrenals is, you've got to look at adrenals, thyroid, and the sex hormones.
And
they're
the
triad.
Writing down to ask you hypothyroidism, because I'm going to see this going hand in hand now.
Yeah. So what I realized what's happening in the naturopathic world is that practitioners were trying to treat one thing at a time.
Mm-hmm.
Or, you know, they would look at the low thyroid and just give a desiccated thyroid or armor thyroid and think they were doing a great job because it wasn't synthetic. But everybody kind of missed the point. Instead of waiting till these organs are collapsing and give hormone replacement, I go back to the minerals. When I was researching for my ReMag multiple mineral, I saw that the thyroid uses 9 different minerals in the production of thyroid hormones. So it's not just iodine. It's not just high doses of this one mineral. What we had that problem with calcium. We're having that problem with vitamin D. And I consider it a problem with iodine when you don't have selenium for the next step in the pathway, mm-hmm. and then manganese and copper and zinc and magnesium. So what I've done with the minerals, and you know, myself as a guinea pig again, when I was testing my ReMag, it was about 2 months into it that I realized that I was a little more hyper than usual, and took my pulse and realized I did not need my Armour thyroid 60 milligrams anymore. Wow. My thyroid was back functioning.
So your cold extremities, body temperature low. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, feel it.
Yay.
Yeah. So anyway, that's thyroid. With adrenals, I'm focused on the sodium in the sea salt and the water. Also, a lot of magnesium is important for the adrenals and the other minerals as well, zinc and potassium. But I don't go for these, shots of potassium. I think they're using cream of tartar to try to push the adrenal glands and get extra potassium, but you don't know the milligram dosage of that. So I'm really concerned. There's a lot of wonderful information on the internet, but there's forums where inappropriate recommendations are made by lay people to other people, and I think a lot of people are getting into trouble because they don't have a good source to ask about the basics. The blind leading the blind.
A few more and then we'll wrap things up. Blood clots and angina.
Well, angina, that's where the heart muscles start squeezing and causing pain. So that's definitely a magnesium deficiency. With blood clots, I've said in some places that magnesium is like a blood thinner, but it is absolutely not going to thin your blood inappropriately. Yeah.
Right.
So what it does, it's... it helps to dissolve the calcium where too much calcium will cause blood clots. So it in the face of dehydration, too much calcium and not enough magnesium, that's when you can get blood clots. So magnesium just helps dissolve that excess calcium.
Very good. Alzheimer's.
We've got people telling us that they're taking their parents out of long-term care when they get on our formulas.
Wow.
Because they start getting hydrated, they start getting their minerals, they start detoxifying. And these conditions, Alzheimer's is the buildup of toxicity. It can be the mercury in the vaccines. When you look at statistics on elderly that get flu shots every year, they have a higher incidence of Alzheimer's from that mercury. Mm-hmm. Magnesium detoxifies mercury. So the remineralization, rehydration is very important.
So if I've got mercury fillings in my mouth that I haven't gotten taken out at, I should be doing my magnesium.
Exactly. And when you have mercury in your mouth, I tell people not to swish the ReMag in their mouth, but just put in water and swallow it down. You don't want to be pulling mercury out of your mouth with minerals.
That makes sense.
And the other thing that I focus on too is methylated bees and precursors to glutathione. Methionine is one. I use taurine. There's a formula, a gentle detox formula that I have called Realign that really does help pull the mercury out of your tissues. Methionine is a precursor to glutathione, which is our major antioxidant, which is what pulls out heavy metals.
And that precursor is better than getting the glutathione itself, which can be broken down or not digested well?
Exactly. Oral glutathione, it goes through the liver, it doesn't work. IV glutathione, very expensive. Mm-hmm. Chelation, very expensive. And also, when you chelate, when you force a chelation on the body, you pull out heavy metals and your minerals. Mm-hmm. When I experimented on myself, giving myself 5 E chelation. It took me 2 chelations before my knees started to ache from calcium deficiency. So you're pulling out and you're never going to put back what you're pulling out. I have grave concerns about the overuse of chelation. And
Would an example of that even be cilantro, taking lots of cilantro?
That's a good point. It could be, I mean, anything in excess. Mm-hmm. I mean, the iodine in excess, yes, it could be. But, you know, when you look at oregano oil, yeah, for example, yeah, for yeast, oregano will kill good and bad bacteria as well as the yeast. So when you really have to be cautious. I mean, I had someone email me one day and said, I'm eating 12 bananas a day. What do you think? And it's like, I think that's pretty stupid.
Balance, middle road.
Yeah.
And on that note, I don't think you'll get it from bananas, but acid reflux, heartburn, and even ulcers.
Right. Well, when you get acid reflux, can come from a stomach spasm, mm-hmm, and an irritation under the diaphragm, or the diaphragm's clamping down on the stomach. There's your spasm. There's your muscle that needs to be relaxed. So I have a lot of people telling me when they get their magnesium going, they no longer have the heartburn. But then you look at yeast too. Are you feeding yeast that's, you know, traveled up from your large intestines, your small intestines, and even into your stomach? Do you have a coated tongue? So you can get, you know, gas and heartburn from yeast overgrowth as well.
Fascinating. And what about ulcers?
That's Helicobacter pylori. And what happens there is the stomach doesn't have enough acidity, mm-hmm, to kill bacteria. That's what the part of the acid stomach is supposed to be. And, you know, I wonder, you know, about the drinking a lot of alkaline water.
Yep.
Are you neutralizing your stomach acid?
So
it's not.
Mm-hmm. It's a question that's befuddled Jessica and I, which is, we stopped doing the alkaline water. I actually was testing myself at one point and getting alkaline and I'm going, and the books are saying you can't. And I'm like looking at this strip and I'm going, wow, I'm pretty basic here. But it got us thinking about things like apple cider vinegar and how it has a reverse effect in the body. Mm-hmm. So that sounds like, mm-hmm, where you're going.
Exactly. You eat the foods that will break down and cause an alkaline effect. I mean, this business about taking baking soda, mm-hmm, to alkalize the body, I think that's a medicinal approach. You're trying to force a pH instead of eating the foods that are going to naturally balance your pH, taking the minerals that have alkaline aspects. I mean, mm-hmm, magnesium is a big alkalizer. So anyway, with ulcers, you want to have good stomach acid. So a lot of people, especially as we age, we do have to take hydrochloric acid. Pancreatic enzymes are not going to help your stomach acid. You have to take either a separate hydrochloric acid or start with the apple cider vinegar. I couldn't take that, so I have to take a combination of hydrochloric acid and pancreatic enzymes.
Okay. How about words of wisdom for parents with kids? Let's go what parents should be doing for kids, and how about people, women who are pregnant?
Oh, pregnancy, absolutely need the magnesium. I mean, the midwives used to talk about the salts, mm-hmm, which is Epsom salts. And for a pregnant woman to not be taking magnesium, they're setting themselves up for eclampsia, preeclampsia. That's fluid retention, high blood pressure, and seizures.
Wow.
What do? They put you on an IV drip of magnesium. Why don't they do that beforehand? Why don't they do it for all seizures and blood pressure and edema? Mm-hmm. And for children, absolutely. I have a little section in the Magnesium Miracle that children need magnesium just as much as adults do, and maybe even more, because they're not eating properly. You cannot get parents who, you know, both parents are working and all that goes with that. You can't get them to cook meals at home. The kids are eating junk food. They need to take extra magnesium.
And I'm thinking of things like, well, myself growing up, ADHD, bouncing off the walls, inability to focus, brain fog, meltdowns, everything along, Asperger's, everything along the spectrum. I would think to some extent magnesium could help.
Oh, absolutely. I cannot tell you how many lives have been saved by using magnesium. And the other minerals are important too, and trying to get the kid to drink more water. And young people will say, oh my gosh, I feel so much better. You know, give me my yucky minerals.
I call it, with our mineral water that we take, I call it our sharp water. there's been this talk for years of an aspirin a day keeps the doctor away, an aspirin for heart disease and for strokes, and I think you might say magnesium a day instead.
Absolutely, I think so. I haven't seen the studies on it yet, but when you look at what aspirin does, even one aspirin a day, the way it works is it causes bleeding. So it's like bloodletting. It's a modern form of bloodletting.
Oh no!
So aspirin has a lot of side effects, but you really have to go digging to find those studies. But they are there. And yes, I would use magnesium
for people who are at risk of strokes. That would be a benefit. Then get them.
Yeah, but I'm not gonna. You know, if someone asks me on the radio show or emails me, I'm not gonna say, "Oh, stop taking your aspirin." Do your own research and figure it out yourself.
Okay. Any last words of wisdom that you would give people?
Oh my gosh, you have gone through the whole, you have covered the
water. I tried to cover as much as you can, so you're driving home and you're going completely overwhelmed. Just forget everything I said and put a little magnesium in and see what happens.
Yeah.
That's where I'm going. That's where Jessica and I are going to go. Actually, tonight I'm going to take an Epsom bath. Salt bath.
Which will calm you down so you'll be able to pronounce words again.
I will no longer be the squirrel on crack that I've been known to be.
And, well, yeah, words of wisdom. I will definitely go and plug my radio show, tell people to come to achieveradio.com at 4 p.m. Pacific on Mondays. Just get involved with my online newsletter. It's free. You can go there and get 2 free ebooks on my minerals under my wellness program, and that has 4 free weeks for people to see what I do over a 2-year period. See, Michael, I thought I could educate people into getting healthy. You know, follow my program for 2 years. People don't have time. I cannot tell you how many people say, just tell me what to take. And then, you know, the 10 years I tried to find a magnesium that was non-laxative, I found, okay, I'll create it. Okay, you want products? I'll give you products. Stop complaining. So, you know, then people complain, oh, you're just trying to sell me something. You can't please everybody, right?
No, all you can do is the best you can do. And my heart-o-meter, it's a new term I think I just came up with, heart-o-meter, suggests that you're coming from that place of heart. And that's why you're doing this. So you're clearly passionate about it. You are on a complete and total mission to change the world by getting people, change the world through magnesium. It doesn't sound too over the top. Crazy, yes, but in a very good way.
Thank you very much, Michael. And you're coming from the same place. I can see that.
Thank you
so much. Well, and yes, when you get back here, we'll do a non-hypoglycemic visit around the flea market.
Oh, that would be much appreciated, with the head nice and calm and relaxed. And I am doing much, much, much better. But there's still a ways to go, and I think magnesium is going to be an important component. So I'm very thankful that you had me read these books. I'm very thankful for you being on the show today. I think it's going to help me. I think it's going to help Jessica, my family. Oh, last quick comment. Mom says, I shouldn't be taking magnesium. My doctor told me that in my blood serum levels, I'm high and I should not take magnesium.
Wow. She actually had her serum magnesium levels checked?
Her regular, whatever her regular blood test is, she said, doctor said I'm high, I shouldn't take magnesium.
Wow. First of all, I can't believe that. I've never heard anyone high. Sorry, Mom. Did she take magnesium just before her test?
I doubt it very, very much. I don't believe she takes any supplements.
Well, it was a lab error. It'd be interesting
to see.
So we're
going to get her back in there. Mom, if you're listening to this, we're getting you back in for an RBC.
RBC.
Let's wrap this up one last time on your website, and then we'll let everybody get back on the road.
My website, drcarolyndean.com.
Beautiful.
Actually, my product website is rnareset.com, so come on over.
And everybody, inspirenationshow.com. We have all the links. If you haven't subscribed already, subscribe, listen to the show on a regular basis. We'll have more fun, experts, advice, heartfelt people on the show. For everyone out there, thank you so much for listening. This is Michael Sandler saying be well, have fun, get your magnesium, and shine bright.
Woohoo! Thank you, Mike. Aloha.
Aloha and mahalo. Thank you.
Thank you.
Sure to like below. Also, leave your comments. Have some real fun with it. Subscribe to our channel where you're going to get more great videos, more interviews coming up. And check out our website, inspirenationshow.com. That's where you'll find tips, blogs, information, videos you won't find anywhere else, and useful and helpful resources to really help you kickstart your life and to shine bright. Thanks so much again. Thank you for your support. Like, comment, subscribe, see the website. Thanks so much and have fun. Of course, shine bright. Woohoo!